We've talked a lot about different measures, and now we're going to cover different ways to display your data in a meaningful way that anyone can understand. Selecting the right chart takes a little thought about why we are studying the data, showing it in a crisp manner that allows the intended user to easily understand and analyze the data without getting into the granular details is the prime objective behind using charts.
People use the terms charts and graphs interchangeably, but are they the same thing? The word chart is actually used as a catch-all term for the graphical representation of data. Graph refers to a chart that specifically plots data along two dimensions, like on graph paper. A chart is a type of representation of a set of data which makes the user understand it in a better manner. By using a chart, we can better understand current results and predict future results based on the patterns of the data.
In this section, we will cover six common baseline data display tools: the run chart, control chart, histogram, box plot, column chart, and Pareto chart. We are in the measure phase of the make, not yet in analyze. In this section, we'll learn about these six workhorse charts so that you know your best options for displaying your baseline data. Remember, you'll have to collect the same data for your after picture once the process has been improved. In the analyze section of your green belt training, you learn how to analyze these and other charts to understand the data more deeply. It's like teaching a yodeling class. Probably the hardest thing to keep the students from just trying to yodel right from the beginning. You see, we build to that. So you've got to build up to that standard. Just like we methodically build your knowledge of data display. So for now, let's get familiar with the basic construction and purpose of these six charts.
So let's look at line chart versus a run chart over time. Most people are familiar with line charts. They're among the most frequently used type of chart. A line chart can be used in multiple ways. On the left is a line chart, but it's just as easily could have been done as a column or a bar chart. The y-axis is the sales dollars and the x-axis is the locations. A run chart or a timeline chart is a variation of line charts. The main difference is that a run chart is always plotted over time. The x-axis will always be a measure of time, such as week, month, or day. And displaying the data in a run chart allows us to recognize patterns in the data and understand more about our process. To properly analyze a run chart, it should have between 24 and 30 data points. A run chart can accommodate discrete or continuous data on the y-axis. And the key to interpreting or understanding these patterns is the inclusion of a median line.
An example data set with simple instructions to create a run chart are included in the measure phase templates. To create a run chart, the data must be in date order and properly segmented for the chart. For example, if we want to show our data as an average by week, then we have to have a column with a weekly average in our spreadsheet. It's important to understand what each data point on the run chart is showing. In our example, each data point is showing the sum of sales for the week. But depending on our measure, each data point could just as easily be an average or a count or a proportion, etc.
Since a run chart works best with 24 to 30 data points, we also have to consider how we display the time along the x-axis. For example, if you want to show a year's worth of data, you wouldn't want to plot it by day, or you'd have 365 data points on the chart, which would not only be graphically unpleasing, it would be a real challenge to analyze. So you can either roll the data up into weeks, like we did here, or you can use a shorter cut of time. We'll get into the deeper analysis of the run chart during the analyze phase.
Everything that we said about a run chart applies to a control chart, except We use the average instead of the median as the center line. A control chart has more elements than the run chart, and because of that, it has a lot more capability to detect patterns in variation. You can think of the control chart as the bigger, meaner cousin of the run chart.
On the picture on the left, you see the average as the center line. And then we also see a line towards the top called the upper control limit, towards the bottom called the lower control limit. The UCL and the LCL are derived from the data using the standard deviation. And now that you understand standard deviation, this will make sense. In simple terms, the average plus 3 standard deviations is the upper control limit. This means that statistically, we can predict with a high degree of confidence that the data will not go higher than this point. And the same with the lower control limit. The average minus 3 standard deviations is the lowest predictable data point.
In Excel, creating a control chart isn't hard, but you have to add columns yourself to get the UCL and LCL lines on the chart. If you are using statistical software, all the calculations are obviously done for you. In software that specializes in stats, there are many different types of control charts to choose from. But for Greenbelt purposes and using Excel, we are covering a basic but still robust way to use a control chart.
We've already seen this type of graphic when we were talking about sigma and standard deviation. A histogram is used to graphically display the center, the shape, and the spread of a set of continuous data. It requires at least 30 data points to properly interpret. A histogram can look like a column chart to the untrained user, but there are a few significant differences. The y-axis of a histogram is always the count or frequency of occurrences. For example, look at the chart on the right. How many units fell into the first grouping of sales dollars? 13? And how about the second group? 22. Also, a bar chart has space between each bar. A histogram doesn't. And lastly, in a histogram, the groupings along the bottom, or the x-axis, are called bins. Choosing bins can be done by hand for simple histograms in most cases. For example, if you're making a histogram for exam scores, choosing bins that matches grades, 70 to 79, 80 to 89, 90 to 100, is a fairly obvious choice. You have two numbers associated with each bin. The low value, sometimes called the bin low, which in this example would be 70, 80, and 90, and the high value, sometimes called the bin high, which for this example is 79, 89, 100. In most cases, though, choosing bins isn't going to be that simple, especially for huge data sets. When dealing with large sets of numbers, you're usually better off using technology like Excel to help to create a good chart.
In our Excel template, we've provided sample data and some simple instructions to create a histogram using the sample data. We will cover the analysis of the histogram in the Analyze module. Before we get to our next chart, we need to cover a few mathematical definitions. First is quartiles. Quartiles are the values that divide a list of numbers into quarters. We have a simple example data set here. To define the quartiles, the first step is to put these numbers in order from lowest to highest.
The next step is to cut the list into four equal parts. The quartiles are the cuts. So the result is that quartile 1 is 4, quartile 2, which is also the median, is 5, quartile 3 is 7. Sometimes a cut is between two numbers. Then the quartile is the average of those two numbers. For example, cut this data into quarters. In this case, quartile 2 is halfway between 5 and 6. If we add 5 plus 6 and divide by 2, we get 5.5. So quartile 1 is 3, quartile 2 is 5.5, and quartile 3 is 7.5.
Okay, back to our first example. Another term that you should know is the interquartile range, or the IQR. This is from quarter 1 to quarter 3. To calculate it, just subtract quarter 1 from quarter 3. In this example, quarter 3, or 7, minus quarter 1, which is 4, equals to 3. The interquartile range is equal to 3. The IQR is used to calculate the predictable maximum and minimum values. Now, using a chart called the box plot, or the box and whisker plot as it's also known, we can show all the important values as shown in this example. We see the five number summary. The lowest value at 2, Q1 at 4, Q2 or the median at 5, Q3 at 7, and the highest value at 8. And the interquartile range is Q3 minus Q1 or 3. This is a box plot.
In your workbook is a practice scenario for you to try a simple example for yourself. There's an example data set. First, the numbers need to be put into order. This has been done for you because we're nice guys. Then you'll need to cut the data set into quarters. In this case, 4 sets of 3 numbers. In this example, all of the quartiles are between numbers. Q1 is between 4 and 4. If we average the two 4s, we can define that Q1 is 4. Q2 is between the 10 and 11, so the average is 10.5. Q2 is 10.5. And Q3 is between 14 and 60, so Q3 is 15. Now you have all the information you need to draw a box plot. Use the scale in your workbook page and draw the boxes and whiskers in the appropriate place above the scale. So draw a box from Q1 to Q2, that's the median, and then the other side of the box from Q2 to Q3. Draw a line or a whisker out to the left to the lowest value, which is 3, and then to the right to indicate the highest value, which is 18. In the interquartile range is Q3 minus Q1, or 15 minus 4. The IQR equals 11. And your chart should look something like this. See? Easy.
Now that we have our definitions straight, we can talk a little bit more about the box plot, which is a chart that shows all of the values that we just covered. It's a convenient chart to display similar information as a histogram, but in a little bit of a different way. The box plot takes a set of continuous data and breaks it down into the five number summary. A box plot can be oriented left to right, as shown in the graphic on the left, or it can be put up and down, like you see on the right. We learned what the interquartile range is, but we haven't talked about how it's used yet. The IQR is used to identify what are called outliers in the data. Outliers are statistically unpredictable high and low values. The maximum predictable value, follow us on the chart on the left, which is also in your workbook, is calculated by taking the quarter 3 or Q3 value plus 1.5 times the IQR. Any values that fall higher than the maximum are considered outliers and are identified by an asterisk. Same concept with the minimum value. The minimum is calculated by taking Q1 minus 1.5 times the IQR. Any value lower than the minimum is marked as an outlier.
A box plot is a great tool to graphically display the center, the shape, and the spread in a simple way, and it's most useful when comparing multiple sets of data. For example, in your templates, you have an example box plot. This box plot is comparing the revenue for multiple styles of craft beer. Another important way to use the box plot is to show the distribution before and after your project. So instead of creating two histograms and trying to compare them, you can use a box plot and show the before in one set of data and the after in another. Really a nice way to illustrate the improvement. We'll cover more in the analysis when we get to the analyze phase, so you have that to look forward to.
Both the column and bar charts display data using rectangular bars, where the length of the bar is proportional to the data value. Both the charts are used to compare two or more values. A bar chart is oriented horizontally, where the column chart is oriented vertically. The column chart is probably the most used chart type. This chart is best used to compare different values when specific values are important. And it is expected that users compare individual values between each column. With column charts, you could compare values for different categories. Sometimes you'll see this chart used to compare value changes over a period of time for a single category, but a run chart is a much better tool for this purpose.
Some best practices for column charts. Use a column chart for comparison if the number of categories is small, like up to 5. But not more than 7 categories. For column charts, the numerical axis should start at 0. Our eyes are very sensitive to the height of columns, and we can draw inaccurate conclusions when those bars are truncated. Stacked column charts, like what we see here on the right, are used to show a composition. We suggest that you don't use too many composition items, not more than 3 or 4, and make sure the composing parts are relatively similar in size. It can get messy really quickly. The column chart is one of the most basic, and there's a worksheet with sample data and some tips on how to create it in the template file.
Our next chart is a bar chart lookalike, kinda. This is the Pareto chart, and it's based on the Pareto principle, or the 80-20 rule. This rule was coined by Italian economist Wilfredo Pareto in 1896, and it states that 80% of a result comes from 20% of the causes. So in business, the rule of thumb might be that 80% of the business comes from only 20% of your customers, or 80% of the complaints come from only 20% of the reasons. That's why this is such an important tool for improvement projects. 80% of the problem can be traced back to 20% of causes. So the Pareto analysis identifies the problem areas or tasks that will have the biggest payoff.
If you look at the chart on the left, it's showing sales revenue for the top 5 craft beers. The categories on the x-axis are the brew names, and they're in alphabetical order. The y-axis is the sales dollars. The top of the y-axis just has to be high enough to cover the highest bar, and there are gaps between the columns. On the right is a Pareto chart of the same exact data, and you'll see a few significant differences. First, you'll notice that there are two y-axes, the primary on the left and the secondary on the right. Let's look at the primary y-axis. Different than the column chart, the Pareto y-axis max indicates the sum of all values on the chart. So we can look at the top of the primary y-axis and see that the total revenue generated by these 5 beers was $120,000. This gives us a visual then of how much of that $120,000 came from each of the categories. The secondary y-axis is the percentage that each category is contributing to the total. The first bar is contributing a little over 25%. If we add the first two bars together, it's over 50%. Add the first three together, and so on, until we get to 100%. The line showing the cumulative percentages is called the cumulative line, or cum line for short.
So in the 2016 or later version of Excel, you can create a Pareto chart. If you have an earlier version, you can also create one, but it takes a few more steps. Either way, you can create yourself a nice Pareto chart in Excel using our templates. We'll bring up the Pareto chart again in the analyze phase, as this is a pretty powerful tool for understanding causes.
So we've covered the six powerhouse display charts for displaying your baseline data, but there are, of course, many other charts to choose from. The point is to put some thought into your data display tool selection so that your effort really translates into something good. We're including this chart here for your reference and to help you consider which chart to use. It was inspired by the table in Jean Zelazny's classic work, Saying It with Charts.
When learning involves active thinking and reasoning, we get the practice we need and the motivation to sustain learning. When practice allows participants to gain a deeper understanding or make connections between concepts, you are doing more than passive listening. You are engaging in thinking mathematically and analytically. In the end, it's important to us that we take great care in making sure that the experiences we provide you are aimed at strengthening your competence, confidence, and motivation. Consider these questions to see if you could benefit from some basic charts practice. Pause the video now to complete the self-assessment in your workbook.
In your workbook, you will see a table of data. This data is provided for you to create five different charts. The first practice is for you to use the data in the table to create a run chart of production volume. When you complete this chart, move on to the next chart and continue until you've completed all five charts. Pause the video now and we'll return to take a look at how you did when you come back.
Here's our example of the production volume run chart. The y-axis is the count of airplanes produced. The x-axis across the bottom is the day of the month. The dots plotted are the number of planes produced each day. Did you remember to include a median line? When we get to the analyze phase, you'll see that the key to analyzing a run chart is the inclusion of a median line.
And another run chart with the same data set, but this one is focused on quality instead of productivity, and it's measuring the proportion defective. On the y-axis, we have the proportion, and again on the x-axis is the measure of time, which in this case is day of the month. Because it's a run chart, we've included a median line at 38%. Our next chart is the simple bar chart. A bar chart uses discrete data, and in this case, the data is the defect categories. The y-axis shows the count. In a bar chart, the y-axis only needs to be high enough to cover the highest bar. Our highest bar is 62, and the y-axis goes up to 70, which is fine. The x-axis shows our categories. With a bar chart, there's no particular order required for the x-axis. In our example, we put our categories in alphabetical order.
And don't be fooled by the bar chart lookalike here, our Pareto chart. A few key points with the Pareto chart. The primary y-axis is the count of defects, and the max value must be the total number of units in the data set. Our total defects is 179, and that's the number you'll see on the top of the y-axis. A Pareto chart, unlike a bar chart, has to be in descending order on the x-axis. Also, here we have a secondary y-axis on the right. The max is always 100%, and lines right up to the max of the primary y-axis. The cum line, or cumulative line, shows the cumulative percentage of the total. So if you compare this to the simple bar chart, you'll see the same data, but with more ways to understand what you are actually studying.
And lastly, we have a frequency histogram. This is a simple way to create a histogram by placing an X for each unit in the appropriate volume amount. The numbers across the X-axis represent the production volume. And the X's show how many days produced that number from October 1 to October 24. A histogram should have between 50 and 100 data points to properly analyze. But even with our small sample here, we can see the data taking a nice bell curve shape. We hope you had as much fun as we did with these draw-by-hand charts, and hope that you solidified your understanding a bit. If you have any questions or areas that you're feeling fuzzy about, just join our Facebook Greenbelt group and let us know your question. We'll get some good dialogue going with you and others who are going through their own unique challenges.